This program is a Warren Stiebel production in association with South Carolina ETV. Funding for Firing Line is made possible by a major grant from the John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, and the Friends of Firing Line.
No book can ever have been more pertinent than our guests. And Coulter has written High Crimes and Misdemeanors, The Case Against Bill Clinton. The book has been acclaimed by Judge Robert Borkus, quote, sprightly in style, a welcome relief from the lugubrious Teutonic language in which Clinton defenders described the unthinkable disaster of impeachment. Ms. Coulter examines convincingly and resourcefully the phrase, High Crimes and Misdemeanors. As one would expect of an author that has written a book with that title, the central emphasis is on what James Madison had in mind when he considered the question of impeachment. Quoting Madison, Ms. Coulter writes, the first aim of the Constitution was to ensure that men with the most virtue would become the nation's rulers. The Constitution's impeachment power was for keeping them virtuous whilst they continue to hold their public trust. Ann Coulter is associate counsel for the Center for Individual Rights. She's a graduate of Cornell who took her law degree from the University of Michigan Law School. She clerked for Judge Pasco Bowman of the U.S. Court of Appeals for the Eighth Circuit, then engaged in private practice and as judiciary counsel to Senator Spencer Abraham before joining the Center for Individual Rights. I'd like to begin by asking, Ms. Coulter, did you find in your research any fear that the exercise of the impeachment clause would unbalance the separation of powers?
Oh, no, not at all. You keep hearing impeachment, it's a constitutional crisis. Well, I don't really understand that. It's provided for right there in the Constitution. And the last thing the framers were worried about was weakening the president's power too much. They had just fought a revolution to throw off a king. Which is why in the months they discussed the impeachment clause, it's funny when you look back at it now, they discuss it almost exclusively in terms of impeaching the president.
Well, now, Howard Baker was on television a while ago, and as we all remember, he played a very prominent role in the last days of the Nixon presidency, both as a loyal Republican and as someone who felt a constitutional mandate in that situation. And what he said was that if Clinton resigns, it will, you know, he didn't say that he shouldn't. He said we should acknowledge that if he does, it will move us a lot closer towards parliamentary government. What do you understand him to have meant by saying that?
I totally disagree with that. I think that would be true if impeachment
were being... You understand he meant
to
be wrong when he said that.
it could be true if that we were discussing impeachment because President Clinton raised our taxes too much, or because he didn't intervene someplace where he should have, or the bombings in Afghanistan, and that's why policy disputes are not resolved by impeachment. Character is resolved by impeachment. If anything, I think we're moving closer to a sort of supremacy of the Congress just by keeping him in office. He's so weakened and shamed the office of the presidency. But this isn't a vote of confidence in impeachment, which is why policy disputes are off the table.
But clearly, one faces alternatives, impeach or do not impeach, convict or do not convict. Now, as long as those alternatives are reasonable under the aegis of the Constitution, then to opt for one over against the other is to encourage an acceleration of a process that does encourage at least thinking about the role of the legislature in curbing unvirtuous presidents. Have we reached the point in which it is unthinkable to keep the president in office?
I think so. If anything, I think Congress could think a little bit more about impeachment. It's really striking how many impeachment investigations there were in the first 150 years of this country. In the past 50
Described
years,
here,
there have been exactly three impeachments. They were for federal judges who had not only been criminally indicted, they had been tried, two were convicted, their appeals had run, and they were sitting in jail drawing their federal salaries before Congress moseyed around to the impeachment. That isn't the purpose. Impeachment is a much lower standard, simply a statement that this civil officer is not fit to hold his office. It's not personal punishment. It doesn't separate him from society, put him in jail, take away his life. All it is removing him from office. You're not fit for the office. Impeachment logically should precede any sort of criminal activity, and it hasn't for the past 50 years.
Is the president unfit for office because he has committed adultery?
He's done so much more.
Well, I asked you the first question. The answer is no.
No, we're not. I think that could be a high crime and misdemeanor. Certainly, the reprehensible acts with Monica, which is, I think, quite a bit more than adultery. There are degrees of murder, there are degrees of adultery. And not knowing her name for the first two sexual encounters, she's an intern, she's 21 years old, their first substantive discussion after their sixth encounter. Yes, that is reprehensible enough that it is clearly a high crime and misdemeanor, as is drunkenness. But adultery by itself, I don't know. I suppose you could have debates about that. He's done so much more than just the reprehensible conduct with Monica. But this idea that it has to be some sort of grand abuse of power, it was a bit more in Great Britain because it was used for policy disputes. It was part of Parliament making a run at the king whose veto they couldn't override. But in this country, as impeachment scholar Raoul Berger has said, impeachment was once initiated to topple giants. It's fallen in this country to impeaching squalid little judges for sordid misconduct. And that is what it's for in this country.
Yeah, but understand the nature of patient inquiry into what we're talking about. I asked you, is adultery in and of itself sufficient to oust a president? You're ambiguous in your reply. I think the American people probably would be pretty unambiguous in suggesting, no, that would be insufficient cause. It was, you know, adultery was a day of life for John Kennedy, although he was simply not actually publicly exposing it. But now, then one, for sociological reasons, one asks the question, an elongation or a development of the sin of adultery has to be looked at with some reference to the sociological perspective of the day, so that, for instance, would sodomy be thought of as automatically automatically triggering impeachment? Presumably not, though in a couple of states it's still illegal. And on we go. Now, the defenders of the president, I see them as engaged in saying the president simply has gone a lot of steps further than anybody else has gone, and it is Philistine to refuse to allow your imagination to develop in the direction of liberal understanding of sexual activity, to call him short on this point. How do you handle that?
There is a meaning to high crimes and misdemeanors, as there is a meaning to cruel and unusual punishment. And standards may change. I think tomorrow, if Louisiana passed a law providing for vivisection for shoplifters, I think everyone would agree that that is clearly cruel and unusual punishment. High crimes and misdemeanors are the same way. And what the amazing thing is about this president is actually watching standards crumble before your eyes just over the course of a couple of years. Each step he takes, people say, okay, fine, that's okay now. Well, we had a big hearing. The whole country was focused on what Clarence Thomas may have said to a woman who wasn't an intern. She was a lawyer. She was slightly his subordinate. She certainly could have gone anyplace else. He didn't drop his pants and say kiss it. He wasn't demanding to be serviced with oral sex repeatedly. It was only what he said to her. That was a few years ago. So to have someone say, well, no, these are new standards now, much like cruel and unusual punishment, suddenly we think vivisection is okay for shoplifting, I think that isn't the case. If what
Hold
the president...
Hold one minute. Nobody, as I recall, suggested that Thomas be impeached. It was a question of whether he should be approved for a promotion. Now, I don't think anybody suggests that if Clinton was up for promotion, in this atmosphere, they would promote him.
Well, they aren't as different as...
Promotion and impeachment?
It's not so much promotion. It was a question of whether he was fit for the office. And that is what impeachment is about.
My memory is moderately reliable on this. I don't think anybody said Clarence Thomas should not only not go to the Supreme Court, but we want to knock him out of the Court of Appeals where he sat.
Yes, but there are different standards for what office it is you're fit for. Just as you would expect a man to be more fit for the Supreme Court rather than an appellate court, the president is especially supposed to be fit.
My question is, did they think that the charge that you just finished reciting was sufficient to pull him out, i.e. to impeach him from his existing role? The answer is no. They didn't, did they?
No, but what I'm saying is...
Yes, they did. In Senator Packwood, they said, yes, we can't tolerate him as a senator.
Right, but a fitness for... The founders, for example, expected congressmen to be rogues. All three authors of the Federalist Papers described what sort of man would be elevated to the office of the presidency. It was always supposed to be a virtuous man, and they used that word, all three of them, although they write about different aspects of the Constitution. So it would be a different standard for impeaching a president for a certain sort of misconduct, or a congressman. Congressmen were sort of expected to be rogues, even governors. Hamilton writes that it would take a different kind of man to be elevated to the presidency than to the highest honors of a single state. So I still think the Thomas example is relevant for what standards are. I mean, if the president of Stanford University did what Clinton did to Monica, to Chelsea, people would be enraged, there would be lawsuits. So. I mean, maybe Clinton is defining deviancy down so quickly that now suddenly his behavior toward Monica, treating her basically like a dog and not a fellow human being, maybe that is acceptable behavior for the man who was supposed to be the most virtuous in this country. I don't think so, and I hope that's not the case.
Well, let me intrude the following. To the extent that Madison had most virtuous in mind for the president, I think that paradigmatic understanding of the presidency disappeared very early in American history. The quarrels that took place between Adams and Jefferson, and very quickly between Burr and Jackson, were not quarrels that were understood by spectators as quarrels between the most virtuous and the second most virtuous man. They were simply by different political leaders. So I think it's distracting in the current conversation to say that somebody should be ousted from the White House because he isn't as virtuous as we would hope he would be. That's why I think the attraction of the argument against him has to do with his judgment and also with the extent to which he lied to the American people and obstructed justice.
Yes, obstructing justice and lying to the American people, unless it falls in the president's duties as commander-in-chief, are clearly impeachable offenses. But I think this gets a little confusing. I'm just trying to describe what a high crime and misdemeanor is. There are a lot of different categories. Clinton falls into many of them, which is why he is such an excellent subject for a book about high crimes and misdemeanors. The idea that we no longer expect presidents to be virtuous, they may not be elected because they actually have the most virtue, but that is the idea of impeachment, to keep them, not only would virtuous men be elevated to the office, perhaps not the most virtuous man, but a virtuous man, but the office would elevate the man. And I have to say, I think to a surprising extent, that has been true in American history. Even that rogue President Johnson actually did behave a little bit differently when he assumed the Oval Office. And I might add, only 25 years ago, one of the most astonishing things to come out during when the tapes came out was that there was cursing going on in the Oval Office. I mean, that really sort of shook people up, that in these transcripts of the tapes, They kept having to insert this odd little phrase, expletive deleted. People were really shocked by that. It's hard to even imagine a country that's concerned about cursing going on in the Oval Office, but not what Clinton was doing in the Oval Office. So,
well,
I mean, I suppose
people couldn't have seen any modern movie if they were shocked by it.
And he was a Quaker. He wasn't even using the words they use in modern movies.
Yeah.
But, I mean, it seems to me much like cruel and unusual punishment and free press and establishment of a religion, there are gray areas we can argue about, and I happen to be arguing with you right now about one of those gray areas, and I think the reprehensible conduct with Monica is quite enough to fit into a high crime and misdemeanor. And let me just mention that of the 7 impeachments ever rendered by the United States Senate, they were not for huge, grand abuses of power. 2 were for tax evasion. 1 was for drunkenness and senility. You know, another one for false statements to a grand jury.
But let's focus for a moment on the fear a lot of people have of what impeachment means. Now, I understand people to be using the word disruptive in 2 contexts. The narrow context is, okay, if you throw him out of office, then you got a change in government. You got a lot of judges that have to be reappointed, ambassadors have to be appointed, and that's disruptive. The other sense is in which it is held that it is constitutionally disruptive, not because the transition can't be made, in fact, it's made every 4 years,
mm-hmm.
but because it means that the kind of security felt by the chief executive is diminished, and there would be kind of a nervousness in exercising his her responsibilities in the future. Now, I take it on the first point, at least, you don't really think it would be all that disruptive, right?
Not as disruptive as the president staying in that office after what he's done.
Could you explain why you say that?
For so many reasons, but part of it is his behavior. I mean, we basically are just saying the country doesn't give a damn about decency or care about honor, and as long as you have a pack of good lawyers and spinners to go out, you can lie and cheat and steal. I think it's disruptive to the entire society, to capitalism, and to a democracy. We're just saying our leaders lie to us, and they lie to us repeatedly, and we don't care because our mutual funds are doing well. I mean, that literally is.
We're supposed to say, okay, we'll censor him.
Well, that's nothing. I mean, that is doing nothing. They may as well declare National Kumquat Day. It has absolutely no constitutional meaning. I mean, that's what the impeachment clause is for. If the Congress wants to censure the president, what it does is impeaches him and removes him.
Well, but there never has been a censure of a president. There's been an impeachment, as we both know. But wouldn't that be a singular rebuke to the president?
No, I think it would be precisely on the order of this string of Democrats taking to the Senate floor, saying that the president was immoral, reprehensible. They're appalled, they're betrayed, they feel misled, and now I've got to get back to my office. I mean, there has to be some consequence to what they're saying about the president. This is the president of the United States. It is quite different to say we're indicting you and sending you to jail than to say you're not the guy who should have his finger on the nuclear button. That is what the statement is. He cannot look the American people in the eye and send their boys into war and have them believe we really need to do this, and not have people think it's some sort of political stunt. His word is worthless now, and he's the commander in chief. He may need to send boys into war.
Well, I happen to agree with you that his judgment is forfeit. Anybody who spends 18 months having sort of exhibitionistic sex doesn't weigh the consequences of that kind of misbehavior. But they're going to be, in fact, there are people right now saying, okay, let's censure him. It is a singular, as I say, rebuke. The censure of Senator Dodd ruined his career. The censure of Joe McCarthy pretty much ended his career, though he died. Why would you say that the censure of the president would have zero consequences? Because it can't have consequences? He's not running for re-election, after all.
Right. I mean, we already know he's a pervert, he's a creep, he's a liar, he obstructs justice. He appears to actually be a criminal. And this is going to bring us down in him down in our esteem that Congress finally gets around to saying, oh, and we censure you? I mean, half the editorials in America have censured him. If anything, it just weakens us even more in the eyes of the world, and I think besmirches the office even more. But it has no actual consequence beyond Congress saying, oh, you know, we censure you, whatever. I mean, it's not like they take away Air Force One or something. There's no punishment attached to it. There's no limitation in his authorities. There can't be. He's the sole repository of the vast and enormous powers of the executive branch.
But you speak as though there was no possibility of a stigma having any consequence, and I think we should reluctantly accept this. The whole business of sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me is understandable in the true cynic. But a solemn censure of the President of the United States is something you think he would simply proceed to laugh off?
It's more than that. A solemn censure, I think, of, say, President Carter or President Reagan would have been a stigma, because that would have been the worst thing, you know, you could say about either of them. But you're already talking about a man who has absolutely no reputation, no shame, no dignity. I just think this is such a minor addition to everything else we know about him. I mean, I think it's rather more interesting that the Harvard Crimson has come out for his resignation.
Is that right?
Yes, they did. Yeah.
The process of the formalization of a condemnation. We all condemn what he did, but societies tend to look for rituals in which there is a means of formalizing that disapproval, and the censure is one way to do that.
Well, there's another way that's in the Constitution.
Impeachment.
Yes.
Okay, then let me ask you this. Why is there, since you consider it so irrational, such a widespread resistance to impeachment by the American people?
I have heard a lot of mouthpieces for the American people, and frankly, I don't believe them. I don't believe the polls. I believe one poll, the only poll that counts, and that's the Election Day poll. And the Democrats running for election this time around appear not to be relying on those polls either. Otherwise, they wouldn't be taking to the floor of the House and the Senate constantly denouncing the president. They don't seem to be very buoyed by the alleged polls of the American people. And I suppose we'll see in November. And if the Republicans merely hold the House, pick up a few seats, I think that will be quite an accomplishment in itself. I mean, having taken Congress for the first time in 40 years, that means you have people in, what, you know, 60 districts who had not voted for a Republican in 40 years, did so for the first time 4 years ago. Merely to hold on to that majority is going to be, I think, quite striking, and I suspect it's going to be more than Republicans holding on to it this November, and so do the Democrats.
You're talking much more mincingly now than you were 30 seconds ago. 30 seconds ago, you were talking about national outrage. Now you're talking about three or four votes. In fact, in off-year elections, the executive tends to lose. So it shouldn't have been all that surprising if the Democrats reduced their standing from whatever it is, 46% to 45%. But you say one thing you do believe is the polls.
No, I don't believe the polls. That's what I'm saying.
No, one thing you said is the elections. One thing you do believe is the elections.
Oh.
But short of an absolute repudiation of the Democrats who are prepared to go with impeachment, what are the American people saying to you then? Suppose you were here 2 months from now, and the elections showed that it stayed roughly the same, or a few more Republicans came in, or a few more Democrats. In other words, that it hadn't become the cause militant of the voters, you would conclude what from that? That we insensate?
Perhaps. My specialty really isn't in reading the American people, it's in reading the Constitution, and it's Congress's duty to impeach a civil officer who has committed high crimes and misdemeanors. It's their constitutional duty, and it doesn't say may, as op-ed piece in the New York Times suggested today. Well, of course, you can impeach him, but you don't have to impeach a president. No, actually, everything isn't a matter of choice. Americans are so delirious on the rhetoric of choice. Oh, well, if you feel like it, look at the economy, how are your mutual funds doing? That isn't what the Constitution says. And if congressmen and senators aren't prepared to do their constitutional duty, I think they shouldn't run for office in a government founded on the blood of patriots.
Well, if they're not, and the American people endorse their indifference, what are we going to do about that?
Say we had a good long run of a constitutional republic, but it's over now.
So therefore, you will be guided in your thinking about the good health of the republic on how it ends up handling this issue?
Absolutely.
So if it does simply absorb it and proceed, your conclusions are very dark about the prospects for the republic.
Yes.
Well, that's not good, is it?
No, it isn't. There are so many ways I think Clinton has harmed this country, but just to take one to move beyond the reprehensible acts, and that is lying to the American people and making it acceptable to lie. It's sort of a basic principle, but people really forget this. You really can't have civilization if people just casually tell lies. Everyone knows it, and you can't rely on someone's word. I quote Milton Friedman in the book. He was asked in an interview once, are there any cultural prerequisites? He was talking about capitalism, for capitalism. And he said, yes, truth. Mm-hmm. You can't have capitalism if you can't rely on the merchant's word. And he remarked in this regard how it was interesting how capitalism had never really taken off in France.
Of course, we have only a few seconds left. As you know, what they are saying in extenuation is that when you commit adultery, you always lie about it. It's part of the same act. Still, the invitation to the American people to really believe him, I think, was a profound affront. Thank you very much, Ms. Ann Coulter, author of High Crimes and Misdemeanors, The Case Against Bill Clinton. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
This program was a Warren Stiebel production in association with South Carolina ETV. Funding for Firing Line was made possible by a major grant from the John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, and the Friends of Firing Line. For information about a video cassette of this program, write to Firing Line, 2700 Cypress Street, Columbia, South Carolina, 29205. Or call 803-799-3449. That's Firing Line, 2700 Cypress Street, Columbia, South Carolina, 29205. Or call 803-799-3449.